Hi, I'm Rick Emerson, and welcome back to Outlook Portland on Northwest 32 TV. To my immediate right is Mr. John Rogers. We mentioned blowing up the car downtown, which is the sort of thing that will immediately endear you to Portland, especially.
Portland loves you to blow things up downtown. I don't know. That's a little weird, actually.
It's true. What is it? I don't know to what degree you spent much time here. I know you came through as a stand-up. What are your thoughts on Portland?
Oh, I was up here all the time for when we shot the finale last year, and I'm here for the season opener. I love it up here, and the cast loves it up here. It's just great shooting in Portland. You know, it's tough to shoot in L.A., and also because we're a show that travels, L.A. looks like L.A., no matter where you point a camera. It's, you know, we did one set in Serbia, and we had to digitally erase the palm, you know, the palm trees. You know, it's 2 hours something flight north. You don't have to go through customs like Vancouver. You can drive equipment up. There's a ton of trained people here who have worked in the industry, either through commercials or the old TV shows that have blown through here in the 90s, or a lot of people from L.A. who just didn't want to raise their kids in L.A., and you travel anyway when you're doing film. There's no reason this can't be Hollywood North. I mean, it really is just a matter of getting the government infrastructure up and prepared to, you know, sort of do business with the studios and the kind of, you know, backwards broken way studios do business.
Is it becoming easier to shoot in the States?
Absolutely. It's as opposed to going to Canada?
Yeah.
Well, cities and states have gotten very aggressive about it, and they're not getting aggressive about it because they like pretty people in their restaurants. They're getting aggressive about it because they know it brings money to the state.
We should talk a bit about Transformers.
Sure.
When you are working with an established franchise like that, do they give you a skeleton that you have to sort of hang everything on, or is it basically a blank page?
That was pretty much a blank page, because what happened is I had done some writing for DreamWorks and I was producing a film and met Steven Spielberg, and I'd written something for him to direct that probably will never happen because, you know, he can make one movie every 2 years, so there's a line. But anyway, they said, we have this thing, come and talk to us. So I show up and the room is full of Transformers. And they're telling us it's a giant franchise for Hasbro. They have a deadline they have to hit. And I'm like, I can't really do it, guys. And he said, you've just spent the last 30 minutes transforming robots. We need a writer we don't have to explain things to.
Right.
Other guys would have to come in and learn all the mythology and learn who they are. You walked in and went, ooh, Optimus Prime. We need you to take this first run at it. But the plot itself was very open, and we developed it in conjunction with, you know, of course, the studio, and then the Hasbro people come in, and I pitch out to them the story, and there's nothing more fun than pitching out a movie with giant robots to 15 unsmiling advertising executives. That's the best morning ever. And then, you know, you do the draft, and it goes through the machine.
Is it hard to let a script like that go once you've written it in hand and you know that the studio's going to take it and do something good or bad or indifferent with it?
You learn, if you can't do it, don't be in the movie business. There are scripts where it's like, where I have fought tooth and nail to try to protect it, save it, stay on it. There's scripts I've gone back to 3 years later where they call me and go, your draft was really the best one. You should come back and work on this. But, you know, on Transformers, I knew I was going to be the last guy on that. There's no way in hell. Every director has a guy he works with. You know, this is a machine. The machine movie has more than one writer. It just does. And that's the way you make these things.
You co-wrote the movie The Core as well. What is the sensation, if you can describe it, of you're there and you're in the darkened room, whether it's at a screening or whether it's at a
pretty
public.
Amazing.
Yeah, it goes, you're going to see this thing that you created.
But it's the same with any job. It's like your first premiere, I'm on a red carpet. And by the fourth movie, it's like, I hate premieres. I hate parties. You go to parties and there, and it's all talking to each other and it's all business and nobody really wants to be there for the party. It's pretty amazing. I mean, you know, first time on television to see your name, because it is, it's the completion of this particular art form. If you write a novel and put it in a drawer, somebody could find that 10 years later and go, wow, that's a great novel. You put a screenplay in a drawer, it's a dead thing. You know, a screenplay is meant to be spoken, it's meant to be shot. So, yeah, that's it. That you feel like that gate kind of closes on it. When it's like, all right, I got that one all the way there. And it's not, that doesn't happen all that often.
Speaking of all things geektastic, I really have to ask at least one Dungeons & Dragons question.
Ask away.
You contributed to the fourth edition of the Manual of Planes book. When you're working on something like that, to what degree does the zealotry of the fan base contribute to the pressure?
Well, it's tricky. It's like, you know, Transformers, I came in as a guy who knew the franchise, I knew the Marvel comic, but I was not a Transformers fan. Mm-hmm. So I went on the boards immediately and was monstrously savage. And it's like, if Optimus Prime is not the right kind of truck, I will kill your family! You know, it's just very intense. I had been playing role-playing games for a long time. I'd been very vocal about playing role-playing games for a long time. I've been very open about it. It's not, to me, it's just, golf is just as silly as this. There's no stigma to it whatsoever. So, when it was announced I was doing this, the fans were like, yeah, he's going to be fine. you know, and a source book's a little different than a rule book. I do not envy, for example, the guys, Rodney Thompson and those guys who did the Star Wars role-playing game, because that is taking the giant crazy Star Wars fandom and like jamming it onto this weird little role-playing fandom architecture. D&D guys know that the game's gonna change. And for the Manual of the Planes, it was very much kind of just a tone piece. You know, these are the four or five worlds we want to explore. This is this one, take a shot at. So.
Well, I want to thank you very much for joining us today, my friend, and best of continued success
thank
in life and art and all
things.
Thanks
for having me.
Mr. John Rogers, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Rick Emerson. If you find me even moderately amusing, you can find out more about me at rickemerson.com. And don't forget, you can watch this show repeatedly, perhaps forcing it on your friends and loved ones at outlookportland.com. Until next time, insert trademark catchphrase here. We will see you next week right here on Outlook Portland, Northwest 32 TV. Oh. You know, whenever I say that, I picture this like 80s smooth jazz playing over the credits, like an Entertainment Tonight. Sort of a, yeah. Like,
a little Branford Marsalis, and, you know, that sort of.
Makes me Mary Hart, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Talking, yeah.
Awesome. That was fantastic.
I'm glad you
watched it. That was.